Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. In this video, we're going to be talking about Bank OZK, who just released their quarter three earnings results. So in this video, we're going to go through what the management said about the quarter and what their expectations are for the company going forward from here. As you can see, they had a pretty nice beat on both earnings per share and revenue. Earnings per share beat by over 40%. And a modest 3.5% beat on revenue. So obviously that's a good thing to see, but these really aren't the metrics that I'm looking at for this bank right now. I know the earnings and the revenue will come in time, but right now with the pandemic and the situation we're in, we really need to see the management's comments to be able to assess how the company fared during the quarter and what their loans look like, since the market is fearing that this bank will have a lot of loans go bad. Okay, so I'm going to go through some of the questions that were asked during the earnings call earlier today. And the first question is asking about their real estate portfolio and what the credit trends are looking like. And George Gleason, the CEO, gives the same answer he always does, pretty much, talking about why the real estate loans at this bank writes are both among the safest and the most profitable at the same time. Where the bank has a special group called the Real Estate Specialty Group, whose job is only to write real estate loans. And because of their size and complexity, they get an extraordinary level of attention and care in all aspects of the process related to these loans. And because of that, for 24 years, they've outperformed the industry on net charge-off ratio. And that's happened because not only the real estate loans, but all the loans that this bank makes are underwritten with very conservative standards. Like I've said in all of my previous videos about this bank, they have some of the most conservative credit standards out there for a lender. And so because of these high credit standards, they think the portfolios will perform well in a downturn. And the portfolio, especially the real estate portfolio, was really designed for economic conditions like these, where the financial sector has been doing horrible because of expectations of loan defaults. This is where this bank tends to thrive because of the high quality credit of their borrowers. But at the same time, it's not going to be perfect. This is one of the worst economies we've probably ever had. And because of that, the CEO talks about the possibility of some loans struggling, and that point will probably hit some point next year where we'll see the peak of whatever damage is being done to these loans. But the low leverage and the quality of the portfolio should ensure that the bank will be able to withstand those blows without a problem. Okay, he also says because of the quality of this real estate specialty group, their loans are able to get better than average yields while taking lower than average risk. And that is something very few banks can say, that their loans are both safer and have higher returns than the rest of the industry. And this bank has demonstrated that for a number of years now, where during this bank's 40-year operating history, virtually every year they've outperformed on both safety and performance. All right, so the next question is talking about the appraisals of some of the properties, especially the hotels, talking about if they've been reappraised and what the new appraisal values are to see if the new loan to value ratio has changed in any meaningful way. Now, the concerns for the loan to value ratios of these hotels getting to an extremely high level, in my opinion, there doesn't seem to be that big of a chance of that happening. And that's mainly because, first of all, this bank has low loan to value ratios compared to the rest of the industry anyway. And this comment from George Gleason, the CEO, talks about most of these properties were last appraised when the loan first went off. That was back in 2017 and 2018. And we know since that time, not counting this year, obviously, from 2017, 2018 to the beginning of 2020, we know property values have been going up. And so because of that, when you see the chart of the loan to value ratios, those are values from 2017, 2018. And so because of that, it's very reasonable to assume that those property values went up and were up substantially from those points at the beginning of this year. And even though they probably did take somewhat of a hit during this year due to the pandemic, those loan to value ratios are still based very conservatively with a huge cushion, because they're based on the values from 2017 and 2018, not at the beginning of 2020. And again, here is that chart of those loan to values, most of them very conservative at under 50%. And a lot of people expected these to take a big hit earlier this year when, you know, the travel industry got decimated, no one was using office space or hotels anymore. And even though the values are going to take a hit, no doubt about it, they're already built in, with one being very conservatively underwritten to begin with, and two, already having that built-in cushion of 2 years of property appreciation. That really gives the bank a ton of breathing room for these property values to fall quite a substantial amount before it would ever get to a point where they would have to foreclose on one of these properties. Okay, so now we come to the real big question for this bank, talking about the loan deferrals and the CARES Act extensions for those loans, where just last week I made a video talking about how Bank OZK has almost $1 billion of non-performing loans. And they don't have to write them off because of a rule in the CARES Act, which allows them to have those loans in this non-performing category for up to 6 months. We have it here, 90 days to 6 months. And there's some good news and some bad news with this. First, we're going to talk about the good news on how this bank is handling these claims, where this bank operated a lot differently than most other banks. Most other banks out there just gave these free deferrals to anyone who wanted them. And even if they didn't ask, the bank would go out offering these deferrals to their borrowers. However, this bank tried to minimize those as much as possible. And the CEO says only if a customer has really actually been affected by the pandemic were they going to qualify for an extension. And he goes on to say that even if these loans weren't placed in deferral, even if Bank OZK said, we're not going to give you the deferral, you have to pay up on time, the CEO thinks that most of the borrowers are in a financial position that would allow them to pay anyway. So in his opinion, these deferrals are just giving them some extra breathing room and giving them some more liquidity instead of forcing them to pay on schedule, which could lead to liquidity problems later down the line. Now, the bad news is the amount of money in the short-term loan deferrals actually went up. So for the second quarter, they had just under $1 billion. And as of right now, they have $1.3 billion in that loan deferral category. So I was thinking there was a good chance that this amount would actually fall. However, it did increase. So this is something I'm definitely keeping an eye on. And it's probably what the biggest risk of this bank is right now. But again, these loans have up to 6 months before they have to be paid again. So it's really by the end of the year, we should have a much clearer picture on if these loans will be able to pay it off. Again, like the CEO said, he feels that the borrowers would be able to pay them off even if they were forced to now. So I'm still cautiously optimistic about the condition of these loans going forward towards the end of the year. All right, so the next question is asking about how many loans are being originated, because over the last couple of years, we've seen the amount of loans originated really slow down. And as I've said in previous videos, that's mainly because the real estate market has been running so hot and we have all these other lenders entering the space with less strict credit terms that when times are good, these builders are going to go to these other lenders instead of Bank OZK. But so now I think with the huge reset we had being in a recession, still being in a recession, I think Bank OZK is going to come out of that with a ton of growth ahead of them, because a lot of those lenders that were less stringent have now moved out of the space because they think that commercial real estate is too risky to be lending in. And that leaves Bank OZK as one of the only lenders for these commercial real estate loans. So here is the chart of the real estate loan originations. Like I just said, has been lower since 2018. But again, that's just because the real estate market was running so hot over the past few years that Bank OZK really couldn't compete with all of the other lenders out there that weren't as strict as them. And like I said, now with the pandemic, I think that's about to change, where everyone else is hesitant to lend in the real estate space. Bank OZK is now one of the only companies left in the space. And this is a great quote from the CEO talking about, you know, for the next year, it's probably going to be rough in terms of growth, but instead of writing any loans they can get their hands on right now, they're taking the long-term view to ensure that their credit quality remains intact for the future, which I really like a lot, a bank taking the long-term view instead of focusing on making as much money this year as possible. The CEO says also, historically, in times of economic turbulence, the bank is able to acquire a lot of assets from other lenders that are in trouble. And that's what gave them that huge runway for growth back in 2008, 2009, where the following 10 years from that, they grew book value from $4 a share all the way to $27 or $28 per share. And so again, all of these smaller banks are staying afloat right now. But if we do see the economy deteriorate some more and a lot of these smaller lenders become in trouble, Bank OZK has enough cash on the balance sheet to come in and pick up some of these distressed assets, which will allow them to have a huge runway for growth over the next decade. All right, so here's the last thing I want to show you, not really that important in terms of a question, but just shows how good the CEO is of this company, where back in 2018, he visited every single branch in the bank. And in doing so, he interacted with around 90% of the total employees in the company. And the purpose of that was to ask down at the branch level what improvements they could make to help the retail banking side and make them a better bank. So this is the type of CEO you want in a company, one that actually goes, talks to all of the employees in the company to see where they can make improvements from those employees that actually see the situation every day. And again, George Gleason, the CEO, has been running this bank for over 40 years. And so obviously he's one of the top-notch CEOs in America, I think. And this just shows how good he is at running the company. All right, so in terms of what OZK stock has been doing, we did see a pop today of almost 4%. So we're now sitting right at $25, which is around my average cost. In terms of what the stock price is going to do, I really am not expecting the stock to run up much more. It looks like we're in a slight downtrend. If you look at where the price is right now, you know, if you give any significance to this resistance line, we stopped right at that line, which could indicate that the price will go down from here. But I don't care about the short-term movements. I'm focused on the long-term for this stock. And You know, in terms of what price I'm buying, whenever the stock gets under $20, that's when I really feel like the stock is a good deal. So during a few days back in September, it dipped under $20, so I bought some there. And if we do see that again anytime in the future, I would pick up some more shares. They increased their dividend again, so that's over 40 quarters straight of dividend increases. The dividend yield is now almost 4.5%, which again is one of the best dividends you're going to find in the market. And considering that this dividend, in my opinion, is extremely safe and has been growing for 10 years straight plus, just based on that fact alone, I'm surprised that investors haven't driven the stock price up to put the yield down in line with other companies. So that's it for this video. I want to give you an update on Bank OZK's third quarter results. Again, overall, I'm very happy with the results. The only thing I'm watching is those deferred loans. They have until the end of the year to make a decision on them. So it's at that point where we'll see if these loans are taken off the deferral list and are continued to be paid, or if there's the potential for a real default. So let me know what you think of this quarter's earnings results for OZK. Let me know down in the comments if you're holding this stock and what you think about the loan situation. If you found something of value from this video, hit the like button to help out my channel. If this is your first time watching one of my videos, subscribe and hit the bell icon to get notified whenever I upload a new video. So that's it for now, and I'll see you next time.